If you're able, would you stand with us, please, for the reading of God's Word, Matthew chapter 5. So appreciated the music throughout the day. And be sure to thank those who favor us with the special music. They do a wonderful job. It's always easier to say no, let somebody else do it, or I'm not good enough. You know, the little humility, false humility thing. If God's given you a talent, you need to use it. And we thank God for those who do. And don't take it for granted. It'd be easier if you just sit back and let somebody else do it. And thank our pianists. You know, my brother John, you know, not just because he's my brother, but I mean, he plays for a lot of the songs, so he's obligated to get here and practice, and he complains and mutters about it. So would you please encourage him? No, he doesn't. Encourage him along the way. We all need encouragement from time to time, and I want to encourage you. I'm so thankful that you're here tonight on a Sunday night. What a thrill. I go to so many churches where you don't even see little children, but even on a Sunday night and a Wednesday night and revival meeting night, oh, I thank the moms and dads, maybe especially the moms, who work so hard. I mean, Heather's over here. She has two. She looks worn out. Not really. But I mean, you know what I'm saying? It's a hard job on a hot Sunday night. That's why we keep the air conditioning just a little cool. Forgive us. But you can put on a snowsuit, but we don't want anybody else to take clothes off. You know what I mean? So we do. Actually, studies have revealed that churches with families and children will keep the air conditioning a little bit on the cool side. Now, we love our senior saints, but the facts are you can put on sweaters. If you don't have one, see me after the service, I'll get one. I was in a Lutheran church some time ago. They had all of these shawls, you know what I mean? Stack at the clothes thing, and they were available for the people who thought it was too cold. And I don't even hear complaints anymore. You're too far frozen, you know. Actually, the people are very gracious here about the air conditioning and the heat. When we get to heaven, it'll all just work out. Whatever corner you're on, it's going to be the right temperature. Till then, the best bet is drive-in church on a Sunday morning where you can turn the temperature exactly where you want it. The only thing that never worked for me, Marie would have to be in one car and me in another. Because she's always cold and I'm always hot, and she'd have the heat on and I'd have the air conditioning on. So, all right, everybody that's happy, even if you're cold or hot, say amen. Amen. That's good, because I want to preach about the happy life. Matthew chapter 5. And seeing the multitudes, he, that is Jesus, went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out, to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world, a city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. You may be seated. Everyone wants to be happy. In fact, in the original documents of this nation, it was written that we want to pursue life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The amazing thing that America has never been more unhappy the nicest homes, the fastest cars, the smorgasbord of pleasures on every hand. And the overriding characteristic of people everywhere, they are sad, withdrawn, and unhappy. Because the missing piece to the puzzle of life is not found in things. The missing piece to the puzzle of life is not found in America, though we love the United States of America. The missing piece is found not in things, but in Him, a life of complete surrender to the one who made us, who owns us, a life of sold out devotion to the Creator who created us and who has a copyright on us. We don't belong to the devil, we belong to God. He created us in His image and He knows us. He knows all of our parts framed before birth. That Creator God wants to save you from your sins and then sanctify your heart and live through you every day. That man, that lady, is happy. Jesus called it blessed, blessed, in this chapter. And aren't we so very blessed? I love that little quote. I used it this morning. I'm too blessed. I used it when I was shaking hands with somebody. They said, "How are you doing?" "I'm too blessed to be depressed," I said. And I forget it, you know, every other day, but I am so blessed. I love it when in a store. Well, I was in an airport here recently, and so as I was leaving, the lady said, "Have a blessed day." I left just so blessed, because I thought, I wonder if she's not a believer. And I'd love to start using that myself to say, when people ask how I am, I mean, out in the world, that'd be a great way just to witness. If they ask you how you are, say, "I'm blessed. Thank you, I'm blessed." Wouldn't that be good? And then when you leave, say, have a blessed day. Have a blessed day. That'd be a good way to witness, wouldn't it? If you don't like to pass out tracts, just do that. Because I want to tell you, there's not many people that are very happy except those who know Jesus, fully know Him. As a born-again, blood-bought, sanctified child of God, I am so very blessed. Notice this chapter. First of all, the happy life is now, present tense. It's not just reserved for heaven, where streets are gold and gates are pearl. But in this life, we, through the power of the blood of Christ on Calvary, can live the sanctified, blessed, happy life now. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are the merciful. There's all kinds of religion out there that will agree with us that, you know, to live forever in heaven, we're going to have a holy heart, a pure heart. They'll agree with you. They'll just say, "You can't have it now. You can't have it now." The problem is they're just not reading passages in the Bible like these. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are the merciful. Some are saying you can't really be all God wants you to be in this life. You'll sin here, fall back there, but never forget that the cross was enough. Jesus suffered without the gate to sanctify the people with His own blood. On the cross, He cried, "It is finished." The happy life is now. You can have a little of heaven to go to heaven in. Secondly, the happy life is an appetizing life. Jesus said in verse 13, we read it, "Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is henceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men." When people look at us, I sure hope they say, "Whatever he has, I want it." That's the life God wants to give us. I know we all have different personalities. This isn't all mush, gush, and lovey-dovey. But ladies and gentlemen, when God comes in His fullness, He makes you salty and appetizing to the world. We believe in separation from the world. We don't look like or act like Hollywood and profess to be a Christian still. But there isn't anything about our separation or distance from the world that is attractive unless it has the appetizing saltiness of Jesus coming through. That in your conversation, the sweetness of Jesus is heard. That in your actions, the joy of the Lord is evident. That when you are poked, I think it was Uncle Buddy Robinson, the old Nazarene, that when you are poked, he said, honey, comes out. Oh, there is no better way to live than in the joy of the Spirit. Blessed is that man. Thirdly, the happy life is a contagious life. Verse 14, we are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. If you want to be happy, let your light shine for Jesus. My grandmother, I hate to make an awful confession on my grandmother. She's 95, maybe not long for this world, but, you know, she did like country and Western music. And, of course, we, growing up in the Holiness Church, we didn't listen to country and Western music unless it was gospel. And I'll just put this in free. You may like country and Western music, but if they're singing about somebody else's wife in with some other man and all this mess and the booze and all that, you ought to be ashamed of yourself. I hear people are so upset about rock music. Well, of course we're upset about rock music. The music itself is of hell. Country and Western music, maybe you like that a little better, But there's something almost worse about it because you can understand the words. And the words are terrible. The words are terrible. But some of those old country and Western singers would sing gospel songs. And you can write me up or write me off, but we would listen to those songs. And there was a song. Well, I'll just tell you how it is. I was up to Michigan. Rick Malloyd, dear friend of mine, excellent singer. Great preacher, and we're privileged to have him part of our church. He called me up to his church for revival numbers of years ago up in Michigan. He had a great church going on up there, and he had a school, and he took me to an auction. They were buying stuff for the school. They were buying things for the gym. And the basketball players or whoever it wasn't any big time sports stuff, but he was calling them the Beacons. Oh, I said, that's a great name. I know the theme song you ought to have. It was an old song that my grandma had from a country and Western singer. He wasn't at all impressed with my suggestion. You can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. Have you ever heard that song? I'm telling you. Fanny Crosby wrote it years ago. No, she didn't. I don't know who wrote it. I think it was Homer, Lister, or somebody with a name like that. You can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. But I'll tell you what. Randy Stratton's making fun of me right now. You know, Randall went through Penview. He got upper crust. The Lord's really helping them, though. He's stuck around Beavertown Church. He just kind of goes with the flow now. Did you notice that? And I'll tell you, isn't that a lovely young lady he's been bringing to church? I'll tell you, we're just excited for Randall. And well, I don't know if I think she'd like this song. You can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. There's a little light in all of us by God's design, but you can't be a beacon if your light don't shine. I still think that would have been an excellent theme song for that school, but Brother Malloy did not agree. I will say this, no matter what, people with Jesus should be happy people. And it's contagious. You want that, and the world wants that. They're so sad. And one of the things that has stuck out to me somewhere, someplace, some great preacher said that on every pew, there's somebody that is hurting. most every pew. And so always light the lamp of hope in your services. I don't know that I've done a very good job of that, but I want always to light the lamp of hope. And let a dying, sick, mournful world know that there is happiness in Jesus. The happy life is a contagious life. Fourth, the happy life is a narrow life. Matthew chapter 7, verse 14. And if you follow, we were in Matthew 5. And if you go into Matthew 6 and on into Matthew 7, it's all this sermon of Jesus. And whether it was all the same sermon or a series of sermons or parts of sermons that happened to fall into these pages like this, I don't know. But it is all part of the same narrative. And in chapter 7, verse 14, Jesus said, "Straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." We know that it's big enough for whosoever, but most people will follow the broad path, the path of least resistance. But we know if you want to be happy, you've got to resist where the world is going and what the world is doing. They're not happy on the Broadway. I mean, they may look happy on the television screen or on the movie screen or on the magazine cover, but all you have to do is a little research to find out that their life is the most messed up life of all. They're not happy. I, of course, don't even know always who the top movie actors are. Of course, we don't have a television in our home. I hope you don't either. I mean, if you do, throw it in the river and apologize to the mosquitoes for polluting their river. It's just a bunch of junk on there. Even the news, who wants to see that stuff? I'm content just to hear about it and prefer not to even hear about it. I don't know. So I don't always know these sports stars, these movie stars. My heroes growing up, you can laugh all you want. This is the truth. My heroes growing up were holiness preachers. I used to not go to children's service at Penns Creek Camp so I could sit on the front row and hear the preachers preach, like Millard Downing and all those guys. You always wondered what was wrong with me. I'd have been better off going to the children's service, I'm sure. But those were my heroes. They're still my heroes. I couldn't care less about the sports mess and the movie mess. They're not my heroes. And if you've allowed those people to become your children's heroes, I feel sorry for your children. When I do hear about them, I should have started writing it down, but it's sad. It's heartrending. When I do finally hear about them, it's often because they've taken their life. Or they're going into these big names. Or they're going into a drug rehab. They've lost their family. They're suing this one over their finances. There's one right now in the news. I can't even think of her name, but she can't even control her own finances, so her dad's been put in charge. Now she don't want her dad in charge, and it's all in the courts, and it's all involving millions and millions of dollars, and they're not happy. So when you say the happy life is a narrow life, you say, what? To be happy, be narrow? It seems like some joke. But if you look at the Broadway, they're certainly not happy. So if you want to be happy, choose the narrow way. It's a way that limits you. True to honesty, to truth, to life. And I know it seems like a joke, choose the narrow way. But I'm not talking about rigid harshness. I'm talking about a road marked narrow. Narrow enough to be honest. Narrow enough to be true. Narrow enough to be careful. Narrow enough to live right. And tell me, the end of the day and at the next morning, if that's not the happy life. All the promises of God at your disposal, all the protection of heaven at your side, and when the end comes, it's just stepping on shore, finding it heaven, taking hold of a hand and finding it God's, breathing new air, finding it celestial. Oh, it's the happy life. And I hope you know it tonight. Shall we stand together? Closing with this hymn, number 370. Oh, happy day that fixed my choice on thee, my Savior and my God. Let's sing it together. If you're not enjoying the happy life, the altar, of course, is always open. Let's sing this little song together. Oh, happy day that fixed my choice on thee, my Savior and my God. Well, may this holy heart rejoice and tell its treasures all abroad. Happy day, happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away. He taught me how to watch and pray and live rejoicing every day. Happy day, happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away. 'Tis done, the great transaction's done. I am the Lord and He is mine. He drew me and I followed on, charmed to confess the voice divine. Now rest my heart, divided heart, fixed on this way, so center rest, nor ever from my Lord depart, with Him of every good possess. Happy day, when Jesus walks my sins away. He taught me how to watch and pray and live rejoicing every day. Happy day, happy day, when Jesus washed my sins away. The Lord bless you. Have a wonderful week. You are dismissed.